So that is introduction. Based on what you just have so far, I want to speak today by the Holy Spirit on a message entitled Great Rain. My beloved brothers and sisters, Jesus, the Son of God, is the purpose for every gathering. Our Lord Jesus is the purpose why we are living. We are existing today because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatsoever we do, therefore, we have to put our eyes on him. The Bible says Christ in you is the hope of your glory. You are glorified people. Christians are glorified people of God. Christians are the righteousness of God. Christians are the new people that have been made new in Christ Jesus. So you are not in the old anymore. Old things have passed away. You are now in the new. If you agree that you are in the new, new things should begin to happen in your lives. You are not supposed to be dealing with your past. Your past is gone. God prophesied, he said, I will do a new thing. He said, shall you not see it? Shall you not know it? He said, I will make a way for you in the wilderness. Rivers where there is no rivers. Way where there is no way. So today I prophesy to you. Your ways that have been held back. Your rivers that have been held back. All the rains that have been held back. Today in the name of Jesus. This month you shall enjoy abundant rain. You shall enjoy great rain. You shall enjoy great supply. Supply will come. In the name of Jesus. No more sickness in your life. No more disease in your life. Christ broke the curse. If he broke the curse, then you ought to prosper. If he took it upon himself, you need not to fight against it. Because he took it, it is already handled. Somebody shout hallelujah. So rain is coming. And it is not going to be, it is not a physical rain. When God talked about rain, rain in the spirit world. And I believe all of you understand that we are living in two worlds. There are two worlds that exist for every human being, whether Christians or not. We have the physical world where you can touch things physically. Your senses can touch. But there's another realm where you cannot, your physical senses cannot touch it, but it exists. But I have a good news for you. That realm is what controls the physical realm. And when Christians understand it, what happened is we were all dead people. We were dead. Spiritually dead people. But the Holy Spirit came and raised us from the dead. We became new species, new creation. It's not the same old man that was committing sin. No, it's not that old spirit that was sinful. It is now a new spirit that is the one that the Holy Spirit created afresh. Somebody said, I've been made afresh. Now that your spirit is afresh, I want you to know that you now have access to Jehovah God Almighty. God is not a man. God is not physical. God is spirit. God is a spirit. And because God is a spirit, he made you in his own image and likeness. And he gave you his own spiritual life. That life is called eternal life. That was why Jesus came. He said in John chapter 3 verse 15, he said, I am come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. The gift of God is eternal life. He came to give you eternal life. So your spirit contact the Father who is a spirit. Your soul contact the realm of knowledge. Your body contact the physical realm. And so for your body to prosper, the spirit has to dictate it. For your finances to prosper, the spirit has to dictate it. Everything depends on the spirit. You got to move in the spirit. When you move in the spirit, your struggle is over. That is why your case is different. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. The old is gone. Today, there is a spiritual November. That spiritual November must hear all. Spiritual November must obey us. Somebody say, in the name of Jesus. You see, amen. You see all those cars you park outside there? There is a spirit of those cars. You got the spirit of that car before the physical car came. Don't let the devil lie to you. He made you think that you have to struggle to get the money and then go get the car. Without the money, there will be no car. It's a lie. If you know what faith is a spirit. You got to use the faith in the spirit. And it is words that control the things in the spirit. When you know how to speak like God, when you know how to speak the word of God, in the beginning there was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. It takes the word in your mouth to change the trajectory of your life. You can change facts. You can change facts. You need truths to change the facts. What do you mean, Apostle Bala? It is a fact. You may not have a dime. It is a fact. You may be sick in the body. It's a fact. What doctors say, they are facts. But I want to say something. Fact does not really mean actuality. Fact does not mean originality. Fact is subject to changes. What change facts is called truth. You cannot get the truth on earth. You have to get the truth in the spirit. It takes the spirit of truth to change the facts. Can I prophesy? Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, the heavens bear me witness that the spirit of truth has come to us to change the facts. The facts will be changed. The lie they told you will be changed. I said the suffering has to go. You've got to change now. Your future is greater, and you are entering your future today. Somebody shall fire. Great rain. Where there is rain, the grass grows, the trees rejoice, the animals rejoice, every human being will rejoice, because everywhere is saturated. We need rain, but our rain is not physical. This rain I'm talking about is not a physical rain. When rain falls in the spirit world, it means a super abundant prosperity. Because everything that seems to be dying come back to life. Everything that seems to be worn out, they come back to life. I prophesy to you today, in the name of Jesus, every bone will come alive. Every tissue will come alive. Every finances will come alive. Every businesses will come alive. Every ministry shall come alive. Everything you lay your hand to do will come alive. We need the rain. I said we call down the rain of the Holy Ghost, the latter rain and the former rain. They are loose from the spiritual. Somebody shall rain. How does God do this thing? I'll give you a word. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 10, verse 27, the children of Israel were being oppressed by the Midianites. And as they were oppressed, the man of God was sent into their life. And he prophesied to them. He said, it shall come to pass on that day when the burden of the Midianites shall be lifted, and the yoke of the Midianites shall be destroyed because of the anointing. So the secret that God uses, everything that God uses is called the anointing. The anointing is the power of God that changes situations. The power of God that changes situations is the anointing. The oil may not be the anointing. The anointing is a power. It's a force of God. When it touches your life, glory is found. I say glory is established. Power is established. Oh, whatever you need, begin to come. Somebody say, I need the anointing.
Now, the anointing cannot be separated from God. Because God himself is the God of power. And his name is the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is God. Holy Spirit is not smaller than Jesus. Holy Spirit is not smaller than God the Father. We have what we call the Trinity. Every one of them operate in their classes. Just as you have the body, and you have the soul, and you have the spirit. So you are a triune person. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. The body has to do his work. The soul has to do his work. And the spirit has to do his work. That is exactly how God operates. I come to tell you, beloved, when you get water and you put it in the freezer, in the deep freezer, it freezes. It is still water, but we call it ice. Ice what? Ice block.
But remember that ice block is water.
But it was brought into physical manifestation. But if you take that ice block and you put it under the sun,
what happens to it?
It melts. And then as it melts, it begins to turn to vapor and it disappears. That vapor is the spirit.
Somebody shout glory.
So the Holy Spirit is the carrier of the anointing. Whatsoever God is going to do, whatsoever Jesus has to do, Jesus Christ has to lead his Godship in heaven.
He did not come to the earth as God. He came to the earth as ordinary human being.
And why did he do that? So that he could identify with you. So that he could represent you. He had to represent you in the way of sin. He had to represent you in the way of curses. Jesus went to the cross to represent you. And that was why he did not come as God. God cannot die.
So Jesus removed the Godship and became a human being.
Can I have an amen?
Alright, now that he became a human being, he had to be anointed to be able to carry out his assignment.
If Jesus was not anointed, he would not have succeeded. Because his assignment was to bring down the supernatural into the physical.
If the supernatural has to be imposed upon the physical realm, the Lord Jesus Christ had to be anointed.
And that was why you saw that before he began his ministry, and the great work that God of the Father gave to him, he quoted Isaiah chapter 61. He said in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Otherwise, the Spirit has landed on me. The Spirit alighted from heaven and landed on me. And when the Spirit landed on him, he submitted to the Spirit. And the Spirit had to give him the power. The Spirit gave him the power. The Holy Ghost is the giver of power. You need the power of God. You need the anointing of the Holy Ghost to change people's situations, to change people's conditions. Somebody said, this month is the month the power of God is given to me to change situations. I can change situations. Somebody shout glory. So Jesus said in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, and he took it down to 19, he said, to set at liberty. I love that. To set at liberty them that are bruised. That word bruised is oppressed. To be forced to bend down.
Many people are walking straight, but if you look at them in the spirit, if you look at them by designing of the spirit, they are bended.
That was why the Lord released that story of that woman. That woman, Abraham's daughter. This woman, 18 years, apostle. This woman was bended. Come on, church. It's called crooked. They made her crooked. And it was a spirit that made her. It's a spirit. And it's called the spirit of Satan.
adventure. The forces of darkness have made your life crooked. They made your finances crooked. You labor, but you can't amount to anything. Those people who give you schedule, they just keep on giving you schedules. Hey, you are going to work on Sunday. Oh, you're only Saturday. You have. I know some parents who do not even recognize their children because of labor. And I tell you the truth, how much do they bring home? I just look at this and I realize the time I was in Africa, I lived the same kind of life. The same kind of life. I had a degree in maths. My mathematics didn't bring anything home. I was struggling. Sickness every 2 weeks. My dear, hear my testimony. What the Lord did for me. I'm not just preaching because somebody said, hey, you are a man of God. No, I am preaching because I experienced God. God sent me to do what I'm doing. No captive shall remain captive today if you believe in that anointing. Somebody shall fire! I was in the hospital. That was the last day. And I had a dream. They did not only oppress me at that time, but remember, I was born again. I was born again. But every 2 weeks, they have to rush me to hospital. They will say, oh, it's malaria. Oh, it's malaria. Oh, it's malaria. And I was living like that. And I was going to church. In fact, I was a leader in the church. I wasn't a pastor, but I was a leader. Until that day, I was admitted into the hospital. My church, my pastor came on Saturday. And he prayed, him and some other people, they prayed for me. And they left. All kinds of things were on my body. Dreams, everything. They just put it on. I couldn't raise one hand. No leg. Nowhere to raise anything. The Lord allowed me to go into a trance. When God is about to walk, no man can stop you. I said, no man can stop God. No power can stop Jesus. No power can stop the Holy Ghost. Somebody say, Holy Ghost. He put me into a trance to show me what was going on. They brought a coffin, Kurabosa, and they placed what looked like my image in the coffin. I will have died. Because that was the reality of what was happening. I was in a coffin. And they covered the coffin. And they took hammer. I was looking at them. They took hammer. They were about to nail the coffin. Then I heard the voice. Jesus. I feel the anointing. The voice said to me, you need not to die like this. Because it is not for me. And he said, resist it. I didn't know where the power came from. I just shouted, Jesus! And the coffin broke. And I got up. All this was in the dream, in the vision. When I got up, I came back to the physical realm. And I said, okay, Lord, I was sweating. I said, Lord, what is this? In my spirit, the Lord began to say, I am giving you authority to resist. And you will go and you will teach many to begin to resist the evils of this world. So I got up and I called the nurse. Sunday morning like this. I called the nurse. I said, nurse, excuse me. She came. And I said, can you remove all these things? She said, why? I said, because I want to go home. She said, no. You cannot go anywhere. I look at my spirit. I said, that's another demon there. I told the nurse, I said, I want to go home.
But she was looking at things from the physical. She said, you are very fried. You are so weak. You can't even walk. So, and the doctor has to release you. And the doctor would have come to the hospital on Sunday. It's going to be on Monday. I said, no, I have to go today. So the woman, I was pushing the woman too much. Then at the end of the day, she now said, if you know you want to go, you have to sign. I said, bring it. She brought a docket like this, and I signed it. She didn't remove those things from me. She just turned. She said, remove it yourself. So I started yanking off those things, you know, drips and all that. They put on me and yank it off. And I got up. She now look at me again, very compassionate. He said, look at you. Just look at you. You can't even walk. I said, I need a taxi. She said, am I the one to call taxi for you? I said, please help me get a taxi. So she went and called taxi. She helped me to call the taxi. The taxi man had to come to my bed to help me. I couldn't walk into the taxi. So the taxi man was speaking my dialect to me and was saying, what happened to you? I said, it's a long story. Just take me home. I got home that day. I took shower. I had only one suit that time. One suit. So I went to my suit. I dusted it. I put on my suit. I felt like, I said, I'm going to church. You know, that my pastor was ministering. He sighted me at the door. He says, what is he doing? I was walking like this. He said, come. The usher should go and pick me. They got me. Look at the way God did something. Apostle, the man of God gave me a microphone. And he said, what did God do in your life? And immediately I took the microphone and I said, Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Thou shalt receive. I never said the power. The entire congregation. That church was like 3,000 members. The entire congregation. I was afraid. They started falling down. The power was on them. And as they were falling down, I was so scared. Because I've never encountered it before. And I used to think those people that fall down under the anointing, I'm telling you the truth, I thought they were lying. I thought, when I watch them on TV, I would say, these people, they are lying. There is a man of God called Benson Idahosa. When he stands before congregation, we do his hand like this. People will fall. I say, these people have started again. But that day, the Holy Ghost showed me. And he said, this is not lying now, right? Because it happened through you. My brother, my sister, there is power. And this power is a spiritual power. The spiritual power is greater than the power of Trump. It's greater than political power. It's greater than the power of discrimination. It's greater than the power of injustice. It's greater than the power of condemnation. When you get the power of God, no man can condemn you. From today, every condemnation shall be broken. Someone shall fire! That is how I started preaching to God. And I give God the glory. He has kept me all these years.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
So, beloved, wherever the Holy Spirit is, wherever the Holy Spirit is present, I'm telling you, beloved, the yoke of dryness, the yoke of stagnation, the yoke of diseases are destroyed. Last year, in November, I was to go on African mission. I stood on this podium and I spoke to everybody. I said, I saw something in the spirit. It was as if it's a wave of disease or sickness and it's falling on people. And I saw as if millions were dying. Dead bodies on the floor. I told everybody, I said, but God assured me that nobody, none of us shall be affected. And I traveled to Nigeria
I went to the church in Nigeria and I said the same thing to them. I said, I think there is something coming, but everybody should just stay under the blood. I say, stay covered under the blood, because there is power in the blood of Jesus. And after my ministrations there, I came back here. January, nothing happened. We were all jumping all around. February, we did my birthday, and it was beautiful. Nothing happened. It will have been as if maybe the prophecy is not true. March. Somebody say March. Beware of the idol of March. The trouble began. Now, thank God for many of you that you realize what God used me to say, and you keyed in. None of us wear masks. Listen, I'm not condemning you for wearing masks. Because sometimes when we say this, some people get it. I'm not condemning you. It's a level of faith. Because God revealed it to me, and he told me what to do, and I did it over everybody. The mask, we don't need the mask. Did we need the mask? Unless they force you at your job to wear it. But we didn't need the mask. Even those who fell, who got into the sickness, they did not die. The Lord revived them. Because that is the way the Lord does his things. Beloved, I am telling you, greater than those things you see is coming. Greater prosperity is coming. It is the power of the Holy Spirit. Your homes will change. Your bank account will change. Watch the Lord. You will see what will happen in the month of November. Now, point your hand at somebody. Say, watch what's going to happen in November. Say, I prophesy that you will have abundance. The amount of money you have never counted, in the name of Jesus, shall come to you. You shall count it, because Jesus is Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah.
So, beloved, from my text in 1 Kings 18, verse 40, that you and I read, this prophet is called Prophet Elijah. Prophet Elijah was an anointed man. He carried the power of God. But at that time, something was going on in Israel. The king and some of the leaders, they turned the heart of the people, and they turned their heart into worshiping of Baal. Baal was a demonic god, brought in through Jezebel. And that is not the God that Israel ought to worship. Elijah was angry. Elijah was bitter. He had to defend his God. I say to you today, beloved, how big is your God? How mighty is your God? Is your God small? Is your own Jesus very small? If he's small in your mindset, that is why you could not do anything for your family. That is the reason why you could not do anything for your community. But I'm telling you, the day you come out like Elijah did and see that the power of darkness can be dismantled through the instrumentality of your anointing in your mouth, you will speak to the mountains. Mountains shall crumble. This is your month, beloved. Somebody shall fire.
So the word of God says, take the prophets of Baal. Let them, not one of them should escape. And they took them down to the brook of Kishish and slew them there.
My brother, my sister, this is a revelation in our time.
Do you know that these prophets of Baal, they were spiritual powers in the heavenlies? There are many people that call themselves apostles, that call themselves prophets, that call themselves bishops, that call themselves all kinds of things. But they are elements of darkness. And they cause the people of God to be crushed. God is angry. There are prophets.
Are prophetess, especially prophetess. They go about claiming they are prophetess. They lay hands on your beautiful head and give you demonic forces. They give you prophecies. Because some of you, all you want is just tell me my future. From today, nobody will tell you your future.
Your future is already established. All you got to do is to stand up and glorify Him, what He did for you. If you want to know your future, ask the Holy Spirit. The Bible says in the book of Job, He says, the Spirit of God has made me. The breath of the Almighty has given me life. The one that made you is the one that knows your future. Every other person is a liar. Let all men, let God be true, and let all men be liar. If God did not send me, I said, do not take them. Do not listen to them. Do not let them touch you, because God did not send them.
And so I prophesy to you that this month, every evil principalities and powers, everyone that constitutes themselves in evil power in the spirit world that have been oppressing and torturing your life, that stand and will not make the rivers of life to flow to you, I say, you watch what is going to happen. The angels of God shall come out and they shall slay them off and say, evil shall slay the wicked. That is the word of God. You're about to be free. You're about to be free. And when freedom comes, you shall prosper. Somebody shall glory.
So the prophets of Baal, they represent the evil rulers. They represent evil authorities over Israel. They cause the drought. That story that I'm telling you, Israel went through the highest drought. It was Elijah that spoke it into the heaven. But they made it possible because of their evil. So Elijah was saying, no, you cannot serve prophet of Baal. You cannot serve Baal. You got to serve God. And that is why Elijah went and raised his hand and spoke to the heavens and said, let the heavens over Israel be closed. And the heavens over Israel was closed. There was no rain and there was all kinds of problems. Listen to me, let me tell you. America may be an industrialized nation. America may be a land of prosperity. Europe may be an industrialized nation. It may be a land of great prosperity. But if we turn away from God, if we do not serve the Lord in truth and in spirit, if we begin to follow all this Guru Maharaji, if we begin to follow all kinds of demonic forces that are existing now, I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I'm telling you the truth of Almighty God. God will close down the prosperity, but the children of God will make it. Why others are suffering, you will be making. Somebody shout glory.
So we must watch it. This election is not about race. This election is not about culture. This election is about the lives of individuals. You may not like Trump. And because you are black, does not mean you should go and vote for Barack. It doesn't mean work like that. If the democratic way of life is not of God, we got to trash it. I don't support everything about Republicans too. But their own is still very much okay. Why do you love abortion? Do you know what it means to abort? But that's what the Democrats give us. A woman will be pregnant. Come on, go and throw the baby away. The abortion is an altar of evil. It is an altar of evil. Those children are meant to come to life and enjoy their lives. But we are also contributing by aborting those children. We're contributing by giving our vote to them. To vote for somebody who participates in evil, it means that you are selling your conscience.
There may be some good ones among the Democrats, but I come to tell you that
what the agenda is not right. Look at what God used Trump to do. He insulted Nigeria. I didn't like it. You think you can't stand there and insult Nigeria. He called us shithole. I'm not happy with that. But I have to look at what God is doing in his life.
That man has carried out prophetic agendas. There are agendas that God has used him to fulfill. I say Bush could not do it. Clinton could not do it. Barack Obama could not do it. But God used this man to do it. If you don't want to vote for him at all, just stay away. Don't contribute to the dangers of America.
You need to open your mind to be able to hear what God is saying. Do you know that the same man, this, what is his name? Trump. He was the one that went to the Arab land. And I'm telling you, Arab land, the league, what they call the Arab league, they are the most dangerous nations in the world. Those are the ones they call, we call them Shias and Talibans and all that, those killers. But Trump went to them. He said, let me tell you, whether you like it or not, according to the will of God, I am going to move the capital of Jerusalem, I mean the capital of Israel, away from Tel Aviv, and I'm going to move it into Jerusalem.
Maybe you don't know the Bible. I come to prophesy to you. If you check the Bible, you will discover that God said it, that it had to be so. And that is what is going to bring the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the greatest agenda. Trump did it.
You know, sometimes I will think about it. I will say, Lord, I don't want to pray for that man. My body doesn't want to pray for him at all. My soul don't want to pray for him because he talks, he talks uselessly. I'm not happy with the way he talks. So I started breaking demons over his life. I said, God, every demon in his mouth, we break it. You are supposed to be a father of nations. And I sense discrimination. I sense white supremacy. Honestly, it's not that I don't know these things, because some of you say, maybe Apostle doesn't, I know more than you. I sense all those things, but I got to believe, I've got to obey the will of God. When that man did that, do you know now, the temple, which is going to be the final temple, Apostle, it has started. They are building the temple in Jerusalem.
It's greater than the temple of Solomon. It is greater than the temple of Zerubbabel. This is the temple that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, when he comes back, where his feet will be on the Mount of Olives, and the whole eyes of the world will see him. That temple has been built right now.
I say this to you so that you can also think like this. You don't have to say it because I'm black. I got to follow. No, we do not follow multitude to sin. Because somebody has a white skin, you cannot hate. I want to tell you, beloved, hatred is not in your DNA. You have to love everybody. Love the white man. Love the black man. Love the yellow man if they exist. Love the blue man. You got to love everybody.
The Christianity is about love. Thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And thou shalt love your neighbor as yourself. Who is your neighbor? A white man is your neighbor. A white woman is your neighbor. They may not know God, but you got to show them the truth. The truth you release to them will destroy the evil.
This is how we can touch lives. Christianity is not about religion, brothers. It's not. Christianity is the way of life.
And it's the way of life that God has given to us. So Prophet Elijah had to crush these people because God says so. Today, I tell you, the anointing upon the Lord Jesus Christ has also done the same for us. And I want you to look up. Instead of looking at your problem and fighting somebody, your mother-in-law, your cousins, your this, instead of doing all that, why don't you look at the spirit world? I told you earlier that it is the spirit that controls the physical. Look at what the Lord Jesus Christ did in Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2 verse 15. The Bible says, he made a show of the principalities and power. These were the same people or the same forces that forced Israel into worshipping of Baal. And Elijah had to destroy them. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came and he had to destroy the principalities and power. Let me tell you what he did. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ did. He died on the cross so that his blood could overthrow Satan. He overthrew Satan over your life. You are not meant to be sick again because prosperity will not give you sickness. You are not meant to be poor again. Prosperity will not give you poverty. They have been overthrown. Somebody said they have been dethroned.
I know in America many of us don't know about kingship. But in the spirit world, there are kings. Some of you sitting down here now, you are kings in the spirit world. But you are positive kings. That is why good things should be coming out of your mouth. Don't be a demonic king. You can get angry, but don't sin. Watch what you say to people. I'm telling you, because you are custodians of people. It's not only your children. You are custodians of your community. You are custodians of your even your office. There is a woman you may not like in your office. It is just the body. It is the body. That vibration you are feeling is the body. My dear, before I got to this level, I used to fight like you. I said, oh, that person did me this. I'm angry. Even in my family. You do me this. I won't talk to you again. This. To the extent that sometimes we have to exchange blue. But the day the Lord began to show me the truth, he said, that fight you are fighting is useless fight. Because that does not solve your problem. One of my brothers, I gave him certain money to go and give my grandma. When I got to Nigeria, a long time ago, it's a long time. And because the woman is old, he just took it out of the money. And pocketed it and gave the woman anything. So the woman, she's educated. She counted the money. So when I was talking to the old woman was praising me and giving me blessings. He said, for you to give me this money, and she mentioned the amount. I said, no, grandma, wait. Did you? This guy gave you that amount? He said, yes, that's what he gave me. That's what he gave me. I said, grandma, I'm going to bust this guy's nose. I'm going to bust his nose because he stole your money. Grandma laughed. He said, my son, don't bust his nose. You will need him tomorrow. And that is true. Now he's one of my best friends. As soon as I got to Nigeria, now he's waiting at the airport to help me. Even though I asked him, why did you steal grandma's money? He said, oh, bros, I'm just sorry. It's because I need. I said, but I gave you your own. He said, it was not enough. I said, that's costly. Somebody shout hallelujah. So what is the secret of you rising into the spirit world? Forgiveness. Don't permit the devil to make you harbor all kinds of animosity and this thing against people. It's called spiritual sin. Fornication is not a spiritual sin. It's a sin against the body. Can I preach? Fornication, because you have sex with somebody, is a sin, but it's not a spiritual sin. Spiritual sins are higher than physical sins. Can I speak to you? For unforgiveness is a deadly sin, because the Father will not forgive you. A man that fornicated or a man that committed adultery, if he come to God, God will forgive him.
But when you don't forgive people, you come to God, God will ask you, did you forgive sister so-so-so? Did you forgive brother so-so-so? So if you don't forgive them, I will not forgive. So this month, you must not harbor any sin of unforgiveness. Can I have an amen? You know that we were all forgiven. If not for the forgiveness of the Lord in our life, some of us, do you know that it is our parents? We don't forgive our parents. Oh, she did me this. Oh, he did me that. They did me this. You got to let go. Let go. Forgive your parents, no matter what they have done. Parents can make mistakes. They are not God. You got to let go. Forgive your brothers and your sisters at home, no matter what they did. Forgive them. Can I have an amen? And more especially, forgive church members. That's a serious covenant. Then some of you, it's your husband and your wife. That's where the trouble lies. Because you are emotionally involved with your husband or wife, you don't seem to want to forgive. Your ex-wife, your ex-husband, you must. I use the word must. If you don't forgive her, I'm telling you, your life will be stunted. Anointing is not going to work until you go and forgive her. Forgiveness doesn't mean I'm coming back to you. Forgiveness is because I want to set, I want to straighten my own life. Don't put sand inside my food. Can I have an amen? So learn to forgive them. Thank you, son. Learn to forgive, especially ex-husband and ex-wife. Release them. In fact, pray for them. It's tough, but if you can do it, you have won the battle. If you can do it, you have won the battle. I believe in forgiveness. This apostle, this bishop sitting down, Prophet Zelina, and many of you that are ministers of the gospel, I believe you can bear witness with me. The greatest attack against men of God is from the church. The same members that you pray, you fast, you do all kinds of things. So because we are emotionally involved in our assignment. And then they will come, they will crush you back. Many apostles, these apostles sitting down, bishop and everyone, if you really do the work the way you ought to, by the time you remove your shirt and people look at your back, they say, oh, you have so many scars. It is scars from the church. It is scars. Some will call you names. Some will insult you. Some will even curse you. Some will say all kinds of rubbish about you. Oh, he just want to take my money. He's a thief. How can you call your man of God a thief or your woman of God a thief? But they say it. Do you know that it's very hard to forgive that kind of thing? But all of us know that for us to move forward, we just have to forgive. We have to forgive. So, beloved, love is the secret. Love is the secret of the anointing. If you don't love, anointing will not work. So you got to love. It's not just faith. Some of you, oh, if I can gather faith. My dear, you can gather all faith you like. Your faith will not work. Your faith work by love. Somebody say by love. In Jesus' name. Thank God I brought all those things in. Now, in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 42, look at now what happened after Elijah has killed those evil prophets. Look at what happened in 42. Elijah said to the king, get up. No more sorrow for you now. Get up, king. He said, eat and drink. Can I prophesy to you? In the name of Jesus, you are going to get up. In the month of November, you will eat what you have never eaten before. Those things they say, don't eat, don't do. Because the curse of that sickness is broken. I said the cross is broken. He said, get up, eat, drink, for thy soul. You are expecting abundance of rain. So I want everybody to get ready. It has started falling. Abundance of rain has started. Abundance of rain has started. We have it in the book of Joel. We call it latter rain and former rain. This is the outpouring of the Spirit. The outpouring of the Spirit of God. I come to tell you, God told me this. A new anointing have I released. A new anointing has been released. Every downtrodden people will stand up.
Everyone that has been zapped and sapped, your nutrients will come back. I am telling you, your nutrient is coming back. Your strength is coming back. I hear the Lord say that those that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run, they will never get weary. And you shall walk, you will never faint. Can I prophesy on that word? God is saying to you today that you are going to mount up in the supernatural realm. You will stand and no evil will be able to stand against you. I say you shall eat and no one will stop your food. I say you shall drink, no one will stop your drink. Why? Because you have new strength, you have new power, new energy shall be given unto you. Everywhere they have taken your energy, it shall be restored seven times. Somebody says seven times.
You will enjoy your marriage. New things begin to come in. And I hear the Lord also say this month, those your children that refuse to come home, those children that have left you, the Lord say, your children are coming back home. Your children are coming back home. He said, your sons and your daughters shall be brought from afar. Your sons and your daughters shall be brought from afar. God shall mend the relationship. It is God that does it. When the anointing comes, everything will become sweet. Bitter water shall become sweet water.
As I begin to close, you will see that what God did in the days of Elijah, when Elijah told King Ahab to eat and drink, God also, it was a fulfillment of the prophecy of Prophet Joel. When Joel began to prophesy, Joel prophesied, and he said in Joel chapter 2 verse 26, he said, ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. I don't know whether your body is receiving or it is your spirit. Don't let this word bounce out. Let it enter your spirit. This month you shall eat in plenty. You shall be satisfied. And he said, God will do wondrous things for you. God is going to do wondrous things. I said, things you never expected. He said, while you are yet praying, I have had you. He said, at the accepted time, I have done it for you. So what is coming to you is already done. It's not about to be done. It's already done for you. Houses are coming. I said, new cars are coming. With debts will be canceled. This month, you are going to see wondrous things. Many of you, your student loan shall be canceled.
You know, I gave this prophecy sometime. I gave this prophecy sometime that student loans shall be canceled. Some didn't believe it.
But thank God for Barak. He came up and broke those things to pieces. So now, he made it possible where you were supposed to be paying some amount, but now you can just pay $20. Your own student loan shall be canceled.
If God cancels your sin, your student loan shall be cancelled. Your car loan shall be cancelled. Your house loan shall be cancelled.
Never you play. When God says things, don't listen to it. Don't look at God from natural angle. Because people will say, okay, the law of America. America is a law. God has power over laws. That's why we say he superimposes his power over the natural realm. Amen. If he could raise the dead, that is a law of death. But God, when he wants to do something, he breaks through those laws and he does what he will do. I believe this is your time. If you believe it, you will see it. And the Lord said, I should tell you, he said, the month of November, you shall enjoy great rain. The Lord said, you will no longer see stagnation. He said, you will no more, you shall no longer be small, and you shall not see small things. He said, no more sickness and disease, and no more fear, and there will be no more pain. Why? Because you believe in the abundance of the Holy Spirit. Somebody shout hallelujah. In 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 45, the Bible says, there was great rain. I would like you to prophesy it into existence. Say, there is great rain.
Come on, believe it and say it again. In the old, it was worse.
But now you are serving the God of the same yesterday, today, and forever. So say it. Say, there is great rain. I'm calling the great rain. Rain, follow me. Rain of the Spirit, follow me. Rain of the Spirit, follow me. Not a rain, a former rain, follow me. Fall on my bank account. Fall upon my children. Fall upon my ministry. Rain of the Lord, fall upon me. Open the floodgates of heaven and pour abundance of rain on my life in Jesus' name. As I said earlier, this rain indicates the outpouring of the anointing of prosperity. And so I stand as a sent one under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. This is what you got to do, beloved. Just do this. This is my son. And if I needed anything, I will ask him for what? Help. If I needed anything, I'll ask him for help. If I needed anything, I'll ask him for help. Amen? The apostle of God here, I can ask him for help. Apostle, please help me. He will not say no because he is also. Thank you, my dear. Wow. Glory be to God. Wow. Amen. I receive it. Amen. That's an apostle of God. Apostles believe in seed sowing for the love of God. So, if I needed any help, all I got to do is to ask for help. Now, the same thing goes. The Holy Spirit is on you. But ask him for help. If you don't ask him, he won't do nothing. Please, I'm telling you the reality now. The secret of enjoying the power of the Holy Spirit is to ask. Holy Spirit, help me with the power to walk. Help me with the power to build. Help me with the power to plant. Help me with the power to sow. Help me with the power to heal my daughter. Help me with the power to be married. Help me with the power to be strong. Help me with the power. If you say that before him, it shall come to pass. Help me, just come. Stop looking at human beings. Oh, I'm going to meet my bank manager. Oh, that my bank manager, I have good credit. Your credit can't help you. Your credit will put you inside trouble. You have been crediting and crediting all these days. That is worldliness. Ask the Holy Spirit for help. Ask him to help you. He will not stop helping you. Holy Spirit, help me to pray. Holy Spirit, help me to fast. If you want to fast, Holy Spirit, help me to fast. He will give you strength to do it. Holy Spirit, help me with my husband. Instead of holding his jacket and fighting him, Holy Spirit, help me with my husband. And he may even ask you, what do you want? Oh, I just want peace between me and him. Then he knows exactly what you're looking for. And he will do it. And tell you, children of God, what you ask the Holy Spirit will be done. If I say something now, some of you, because of your religious life, you'll be looking at me as something. Do you know that the Holy Spirit is Jesus' Father? Everybody keep quiet. The Holy Spirit is his Father. He was one that planted a seed in the womb of Mary. He's the one. And when Jesus grew up, he is the one that anointed him. So don't neglect the Holy Spirit. Some of you are afraid of the Holy Spirit because of your way of life. Actually, don't be afraid of your sin. I can't go to the Holy Spirit because I did this. What you did, before you did it, he knows. You think he didn't know? He knows before you did that thing. All he's saying is that, come to me. Ask me for help. I will help you. He is the destroyer of sin through the blood of Jesus Christ. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody say, great rain. Great prosperity. Come on, say it again. Great rain. Great prosperity. Great rain. Great prosperity. Great rain. Great prosperity. Holy Spirit, help me to enjoy great
great spirit this month of November. Help me, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, everybody clap your hands for Jesus and start coming out. Come out, come out, come out to the altar. Come out to the altar.
Brother, we are going to fellowship together. We are going to. I love your spirit. I love your spirit. I've never been what? I'm looking for a word. You say you are Apostle Bala, so be my brain now. Not flattered. When I meet people, when I meet, no, not impressed. I've never been. Every connection I have, they always betray me. That's what I'm trying to say. So I've never been. How can somebody just come to church and sow? He didn't sow to the church, he sowed it to Apostle Bala. Are you jealous? This thing that this great man of God did today, God is going to use people to do it for you. Do you know that people you have not met can release something to your life? Because God will send them. It's God that sent them now. And I receive this with all my heart. Hallelujah. Sir. Where are the children? Please bring the children out for me. Oh, you are all out. Are you all down at the back there? With your teachers? Ruth, are they all down at the back? If they are still there, call them out. Hallelujah. You know, today being 1st of November, I just want us to talk to the Lord. There are certain things we do in the presence of the Holy Spirit because He's with you. But we do certain things that we think it doesn't matter. It matters. I want you to think about forgiveness.